I'm Patrick Watson, and if any of you citizens of the 51st state have a kid in the public school system, it's possible that you wonder to yourself if there isn't another way of educating the child. How many of you have thought of starting a school of your own and then rejected the idea because it was too costly or too far out or too difficult one way or another? Well, in 1964, a group of East Harlem parents decided to hang in there and follow through on the idea. Starting with a bilingual preschool, they submitted a proposal to the Office of Economic Opportunity, got a starter grant, and got the thing underway. And today, the East Harlem block school is very much alive and kicking. They've spread up to grade 5 and down to the daycare center level. They're funded by a mixture of federal, city, private, corporate, and foundation monies. And tonight we're going to visit two classrooms in a film report by Faye Michener. Then we'll meet here in the studio with several of the people involved in getting them going and in keeping them going.
When you walk into the first grade classroom, one floor through in the basement of a small brownstone on East 111th Street, you are assaulted by activity, energy, and noise. Educators call it open classroom. At first, it looks like chaos, but you begin to discover that what appears to be random activity has a sort of organic structure. Small groups of 2, 3, or 5 kids are attacking a particular project. It could be learning how to make a leg that stays on their clay dinosaur.
Make arms and legs, then the arms and legs don't break off, they stay there. John,
look at my face.
Look at my face.
John, look. I'm
going to give you a second.
Me too.
Okay.
Me.
You're on your own.
I like it.
It could be painting, baking cupcakes, tie dyeing, or finding out about direct and alternating currents and how a battery works. Several of these activities are going on simultaneously, but the kids are absorbed in their work and seem to have no trouble concentrating.
If I gave you this, how many ones would you give me?
I know.
$700.
5.
The board of the East Harlem Block Schools is made up entirely of parents. The parents have complete control over every aspect of the school, funding, development, the hiring and firing of teachers.
I like to work with you.
How do you feel about parent control?
That's the only way you're going to get something done.
What do you tell new parents about the school?
Well, I tell them the first thing that I tell them is that, you know, this is your school. Once you're a parent, you become a member of the school. You have a right to come in and say how you feel about the school. If something's bothering you, talk about it with the teacher. Mm-hmm. We want you to come in and assist. We expect you to come in and work. You know, we can call you up and say, look, we need you. One of the teachers that are out, could you come in and help the teacher?
I think the reason why parents often don't get involved in public school is that they feel they don't really have any influence or any power.
Did you read this one?
Yeah.
Michael reading today?
Yeah, Lewis, book 6. I have to go down and get you another book.
Why?
Because I can't find this. What have you done with it?
I put it back where it was.
Well, it's not there now.
The staff has a majority of parents on it. Each classroom has two teachers, one a parent and one a professional teacher. And together, those two teachers develop the curriculum for that classroom. The personnel committee comes into that in the sense that they hire the teachers that they want. And they hire the master teacher and they hire the director.
Right now I'm on the personnel committee, and we select our teachers. We interview them. If we see that a teacher doesn't work out, we have a right, you know, to get rid of them.
I interview people and sort of pass on their professional credentials. Beyond that, it's up to you to select which teachers you think are going to be really best for your kids.
For me, it was a new thing too, because we didn't know playing with blocks and painting and doing, you know, playing around. To us, the kids were playing, they weren't learning. So I had to learn, and the parent had to learn that, you know, this was part of learning. It was a different thing, you know. We were taught you had to learn to write and read, and that was it. You know, you don't play. This is the way you learn.
All I want to know is how many of the things do we have inside that you think you can find inside the frog?
I don't know. Wait a minute. In the frog, we
have inside the frog, we have tongue, esophagus, liver, stomach, eggs, food.
I know where you can find me there. Babies.
Where?
Lady?
Yeah. Okay, well, let's put that in parentheses. Why? You're going to find babies all the time inside?
No.
What kind of people?
Ladies.
They should be pregnant.
What's pregnant mean?
You're gonna have babies.
That means there's already at least a child inside.
Donna asked her fourth graders whether they would like to study biology because she is interested in biology and learn how the body works. The response has been enthusiastic. Every child who wants to is able to dissect a frog, and they take their work very seriously.
And this one doesn't got no front leg.
I bet it's your hat.
Nope. Yeah.
All right. That's well, bad. I guess we can make it without the front arm. Okay, turn them over.
What's
on his back.
Body?
Take your scalpel and your tweezers out.
That's nice.
You might have been in a fight. Draw a line down the midsection, a line that you can see. Draw a line.
You come over here, fat eye.
That's it. Don't cut. Okay. You have your line down the middle?
Uh-huh. Yeah. I did it too. You did it.
Okay. Two girls and a boy. We got two girls and a boy.
I'm a boy.
We found eggs, right? Did we find stomach?
Look, egg.
Yes.
Where is it? Okay. What leads to the stomach? What pipe?
From the mouth.
Esophagus. Okay, so if it has a stomach, it has a what? It's got an esophagus. Now, follow the stomach up. See how far you can follow the stomach up.
I followed the heart.
You found a heart?
Yeah.
Oh.
Look, I found the heart.
Where is it?
Right over there.
That's a long
one.
The heart's up
there. Look, I don't got no heart.
We have a very dedicated group of teachers. The salary is $8,200 a year, which is fairly low, especially compared with the public schools. And so the kind of people we get are people who are here, you know, because they're really interested in education, really want to work with kids and with parents.
We've got at least 104 for this one.
So if you've only got two, you better look again. Does anyone have more than four for this one?
Once a week, for a couple of hours after classes are over for the day, the teachers meet to work with a math consultant.
Which ones do you have for this one?
They are learning a revolutionary method of teaching math involving the use of wooden rods of different colors and varying lengths. They found it really works, and kids are comfortable doing complicated processes of multiplication and division with surprisingly large numbers.
187.
I'll say 100.
Well, we're going to look at them all together.
I know.
If we look at them alone, what do we say for this one?
100.
If we look at this all alone, what do we say?
80.
And if this is all alone?
189.
But if we put them this way, what do we say?
189.
And if I just mix them up a little bit?
179.
179. And if we do this?
My children do not fear their teachers coming to the house to visit. You know, they come up when there's a problem and they come up when there's no problems. You know, if they feel they want to talk to me about something, they feel free to come up. They have that, you know, that right. And I have the right to go into the classroom. I could call up the teacher on a regular basis. You know, it doesn't have to be a serious problem to get to talk to that teacher. We talk because there's a need to, and it's an ongoing need.
The kids are taught individually. You know, it's not a here's the teacher and this is a group. You know, the teacher sees where the kid is lacking, and he or she is gonna help that child where he needs help. You see, and we have two teachers in the classroom. We have the teacher and the parent, so they work it out so that they can help. And usually it's nice because the parent that works in the classroom knows both languages, you know, Spanish and English. And if we have children that don't know the English language, they feel comfortable talking to the parent, unless she's a mother.
Y yo he ido allí de sorpresa y he visto un maestro con mis hijas sentado solo enseñándole algo. Que estaba el grupo haciendo algo, pero como ellas son maestros, ellas le enseñan aparte. Las sientan en una sillita y le enseñan. Y están sin miedo. Y le hablan a los maestros con esa sinceridad como me hablan a mí. Y acá no, aquella tenía miedo de los maestros.
I made a lot of effort when I was teaching in the public school to make contact with parents. But there's something about the institution of a public school that sort of keeps parents away.
Let's see. You really want to know what a frumble is?
I think that some of the serious conflicts that have taken place in the city around education between parents and professionals have come about because the parents felt they didn't have any say at all and that they had to fight for the most basic kinds of respect, which is a very maddening kind of thing to have to do. And here, that kind of respect and the influence of the parents is very clear from the beginning.
Okay, that is a problem.
The whole atmosphere in the East Harlem Block schools is very different from a public school situation. And it's not to say that I'm not in favor of the public school idea. If anything, one of the things that I see coming out of the East Harlem Block schools is ideas so that we could implement them in the future into the public schools. One of my goals is that I think we have to change the attitudes in the public schools. And, you know, that's starting with administration, teachers, paraprofessionals, and so on down the line. And you also have to change the attitude of the children. I want them to feel free. They want to go to school. They want to learn. They have something there that they're going to benefit from. It's not that they have to go to school, so they're blocking it out of their minds. Right now in this district, District 4, we have a few teachers doing the open classroom situation. And that's working out beautifully. And some of the ideas are from the East Harlem Block schools and from England, this method, the open corridor. I see that working, and I see the fact of this helping to change attitudes, because the major problem that we have with the Board of Ed or any city agency in New York City is attitudes. I just think it's a beautiful concept what's going in there, I hope to see this in the public schools.
And I feel like, you know, I'm part of a school that even though we're still fighting against great odds, has a much better chance of really coming through for the kids. And so I feel like part of something that is hopeful and that's that's working.
Y ahí tuvieron tiempo que los maestros no cobraron y le ayudaron a los niños con el gusto que le ayudaron cuando están cobrando. Tuvo como un par de tiempo porque no había fondo.
We have a big problem with funding. It's a continual struggle just to survive. We very seldom know where the payroll is coming from, you know, 2 or 3 weeks ahead. And there's still some of the staff that is owed back salary. And sometimes, you know, that makes me really angry. I try not to think about it.
Here in Greater New York, and it's great paying dues and making news at such an incredible rate. As a city, it gets pretty hard to contemplate, and that's why we've come to think of it as the 51st state.
I have four guests in the studio. First of all, I'd like to introduce to you Mrs. Rosie Gates, who was a founding member of the parents' group that got the schools going, is currently the parent coordinator. Tom Roderick, director of the elementary school, and he was a teacher in the public school system earlier. Mrs. Susan Egan is the state coordinator of the Committee of Community Schools, if I got that right. And next to me, Faye Michener, who produced the film report that you've just seen. And I'd like to start off just from left field and ask you guys what the UFT, what the United Federation of Teachers, thinks of what you're doing in the block schools, or do you know?
Mr. Shanker, till quite recently, has chosen not to think of the alternative schools at all.
You've carefully used the word alternative schools.
Yes. Yes, there are a whole variety of alternative schools.
That includes free schools, parochial schools.
It includes the schools that are now operating inside the system, like Park East High School or PS3. It includes all of the schools on the committee, including the East Harlem Block schools, Harlem Prep, Children's Community Workshop, all of them, who are now making some effort to get some sort of public funding. So that Mr. Shanker has found that he has had to think about the alternative schools and the sorts of hiring and firing arrangements that are operative in those schools. So far, the only indication of that we've had of his feeling was an article that he wrote in his Sunday column a couple of weeks ago.
And in a nutshell?
In a nutshell, he says basically they're not alternatives to the public school. They're too small, too selective. Well, and a whole series of other things that are to some degree true and some degree not true.
Mrs. Gates, would you like to see this idea expand and become the common form of schooling?
Yes, I would.
Do you think that's realistic?
I think it would be realistic, and I also would like to see it go into the public school system if it were possible, you know, that they
How could it go into the public school system? It seems to be at war with the idea of a centrally controlled. So you're really talking about neighborhood control,
mm-hmm.
aren't you?
I mean, one of the things that we've seen quite recently in District 3 and in one other district that escapes me is the development of parent personnel committees who act in an advisory capacity for the district to select personnel for the public schools, a situation about which Mr. Shanker is, needless to say, very upset. But that is nonetheless happening, and that is moving very close to the kind of thing that the East Harlem Block Schools is doing.
You said that Mr. Shanker says the block schools are not an alternative to the public school system. What does the state say? Are they a recognized, legitimate alternative?
Yes, most of them are recognized and legitimate, considered alternative schools. The only requirement that the state imposes on an alternative school, whether it's the East Harlem Block Schools or some mother teaching four kids in her home, is that that group or that person be providing an alternative, an equivalent education to what is being offered in the public school system.
Whoa, what does that mean?
Well,
that sounds pretty depressing to me.
Well, it may be pretty depressing. It's also, you know, pretty open-ended. So that, I mean, if the block schools were doing nothing, I suspect they would be recognized by the state on that basis. That doesn't happen to be the case.
Have you any way of knowing? Have you done any tests to find out how the work that the kids from the block schools are doing compares with the kids who graduate from?
Yeah, the follow-through program gives us money for kindergarten through third grade, and they have...
Follow-through program is capital letters, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a federal program, and they've conducted an evaluation.
And how do you stack up?
Well, we haven't gotten all the results in, but we seem to stack up quite well, and we intend to give more tests of our own. We plan to give some tests by the end of this year. Most of it has been subjective up to this point, or our own estimate given the informal kinds of tests that we give the kids.
Mrs. Gates, why did you start the schools in the first place?
Well, a lot of parents felt, and I myself felt, that something had to be done about the public schools, and this was one way of showing...
But I mean, why? You know, what was wrong?
What was wrong? You don't feel comfortable going into public schools.
You're not welcome?
I wouldn't say you weren't welcome. Sometimes you all, it depends on what school you go to, let's put it this way. And you could go in, but like sometimes you could be standing there for a few minutes or so, and nobody just doesn't pay attention to you. They just like walk, you know, they look at you and they just walk by. They don't show children respect, which they should have respect. They should have rights just like any other, you know, any other child or any other person. The parent feels the same way, that they can't talk. Some teachers they could talk to, some teachers that they can't talk to. They don't want to listen to them. And if you are Puerto Rican and you can't speak corrective English, then they give you a hard time because sometimes they don't want to be bothered.
It seems an unlikely thing, looking at it from the outside, that a group of people with no experience, presumably in education, no experience in organization, could pull this thing off. How do you think you managed to pull it off?
Hard work, faith in ourselves, that we could do it.
That's easy to say.
I know.
Where'd it come from?
I guess all of us really discussing and really saying that we were going to do something for our children and determined to do it. At first, we didn't think it was possible that something like this could be done. We figured, well, none of us had any, you know, educational background, you know, like some of us weren't even high school graduates, some were high school dropouts and whatnot. And we got together. I wasn't really involved at the beginning. It was my husband who knew a couple of people from the block, and they started talking to him, and he got me involved in it, and then I started going to the meetings with the other people that were interested, and we talked about it, and we said, no, it's impossible, we couldn't do it. And we decided, well, let's go ahead, you know, we're going to try, we're going to do it, and we're determined to do it, and we did it. It was hard work. We used to get home around 1 o'clock in the morning, things like that.
Mr. Roderick, were you involved at the beginning?
No, I came 4 years ago. The elementary school started 5 years ago with a first grade class. And the first year, the parents were very dissatisfied with how things went, so they fired the first grade teachers. And then I came in the following year.
The parents fired?
That's right.
The parent, as a group? Did, was this
well,
a
the
Democratic
personnel
voted
committee.
Decision?
Mm-hmm. It's the board in the elementary school is called the personnel committee, and it's a group of parents that interviews teachers and has the power to fire teachers if necessary.
And they fired this person and you took over that position?
That's right. There were two first grade teachers, and they fired them, and then I came in the next year.
Now, if I was a member of the United Federation of Teachers, I would at this point ask you very earnestly, what protection or recourse did that person have who was fired, and what protection or recourse do you have if the parents suddenly decide that they don't like the color of your eyes or the pants you wear or the way you're teaching and they want to throw you out?
Well, there isn't any legal protection that people have. When a teacher comes to the school, he understands that if he has a 3-month probationary period and if he doesn't work out, if the parents aren't satisfied, they can ask him to leave. What I've found since I've been at the school is that the parents, because they have the power, are very responsible about using it. They make a great effort to try to help a teacher who's having difficulty. And usually, when it comes to the point where we have to ask somebody to leave, it's a mutual decision of the teacher and the parents, because the teacher has come there because he really wanted to do something for the school and for the kids and for the community, and it's usually clear to that person if it isn't working out. So we haven't had any, serious conflicts over people.
Would you say your job is more secure or less secure than it would have been in the public school system?
Well, for me, I feel it's more secure in the sense that I really have a solid sense of trust and a sense of relationship with the parents. I'm not there as the representative of some alien culture or some imposed system. I'm there because a group of parents have asked me to come and work with their kids, and I feel that that connection is very important. And so I feel my job is, I feel I have much more justification for being in East Harlem than I would if I were a public school teacher.
Let me ask a question of Faye, because this is the first time I've seen the film, and it's the first time you've all seen the film, mm-hmm. right? But Faye's worked on it. It gave me a very, very warm feeling. I had the feeling of being something that was just really a splendid place to be. Were you putting us on, or is it really as
good as... No, that's what it feels like. You can't put it on. You can't make kids perform.
You weren't just selecting the best moments and...
Oh, no, no. The one thing I noticed when I walked into the classrooms was that the kids will come up and talk to you, and they wonder why you're there, and they sit around and chat, and they're not afraid of having somebody wander in, because people wander in all the time. Parents wander in, interested parties wander in, and it doesn't upset anything, and the kids are very free and easy. They seem to talk to an adult or to anyone much more freely than any classroom I've ever been in.
Do you agree that the film is an accurate representation of the school, or at least of the tone?
Yes, I really like the film a lot.
That's not necessarily the answer to the question. Now try answering the question. The film is almost totally positive.
Right, okay. I mean, obviously there are problems, and the film didn't highlight those. But it's certainly a reflection of what we're trying to do, and I think of what happens a lot around the school.
I think some conventional teachers, and I don't want to use that word as a derogatory term, but some, let's just say some teachers and some parents, looking at the film and hearing Faye talk just now, would say, how in the world can you learn anything in an atmosphere like that? Everybody doing what they want, and they're going in all directions, and they're all talking. What do you feel about that? There was one woman in the film who spoke and said, at first I thought they were playing, how could they learn?
That was Lydia that was talking. Yeah. A lot of parents feel like sometimes if they see a child playing with water, things like that, they just think it's just a game, but they don't know that the child is learning mathematics at the same time, because if he's pouring in through
the funnel.
Yes. The whole water play sequence is volume and space.
It's involving measurements and things like that, so that they're learning mathematics. If you just walk in and you say, oh, this kid's playing with water, he's not learning anything, but at the same time, the kid is measuring the water as it goes in.
Are you satisfied with what's going
yes,
on
I
there?
Yes, I am. Yes, I am.
And you feel you've got a formula now that really works?
I'm hoping to get up to high school and college.
Is that realistic?
We're hoping.
What do you think, Ms. Z?
Oh, I think it's absolutely realistic.
That you can keep on adding. You've been adding a grade a year.
Yeah, I think it's ultimately going to, I think ultimately the funds have got to come from public sources to support this kind of thing. I think you could justify that.
Well, some of them come from public sources now.
Yes, but I mean a regular tax levy, educational sources.
Committed.
Committed to the development of a junior high school sponsored by the East Harlem Block Schools in exactly the same way the public school system would sponsor the development of any other junior high school. And right on up. There's been enough activity in that direction in the city to begin with already, and while it's by no means parent or student controlled just yet, it's certainly moving in that direction, and I think the Black Schools is coming around at a very good time to ask for this.
Do you think there's a prayer of getting public funding?
Oh, yes.
You mean state, don't you,
state.
When you're talking
yes.
about
yeah, right.
the
do you think you'd, do you think those funds would come with strings attached?
Oh, there would be strings.
Would one have to sort of compromise the principles that you set out with when you formed the school in order to continue it on a large scale with these funds? I mean,
I don't think you're going to have to compromise the principles. There is no question there are going to be, from time to time, compromises. And there will have to be. What we do not know at this point is exactly what those compromises will be. I mean, there is no reason, for instance, why the East Harlem Block School's hiring and firing procedure cannot be transplanted into a public school situation as long as the appeals procedure remains the same. There would be no reason, for instance, why a teacher that you had fired could not appeal to the District 4 Board, so on and so forth. I mean, I think there's a great deal of in-between territory between absolute and total parent control and absolute and total centralized control that has not been explored yet.
And Mrs. Egan has given me the impression that she, at least, would welcome the schools becoming a part of the public school system, at least in the sense that they are funded just as any other public school. Yet I've got the stronger impression from all of you and from the film that one of the things you rejoice in these schools is that you're not part of the system, that you are your own school. You are a product of the people who made it.
Right.
How can you have them both? How can you both keep this unique quality and the enthusiasm and at the same time be funded by a bureaucracy that inevitably is going to say to you, well, it's very good, but you really should get your standards in line with ours.
We really have.
Does that worry you, Mrs. Gates?
Yes, it does. But we were talking. We had a board meeting, and we were discussing it, and we still haven't decided. Really.
Mr. Roderick, I'm sorry to interrupt. You were.
Yeah. Well, it's going to be a very hard decision to make because we can't become part of the public school system if it's going to strip us of what is unique about the school. We have found, though, in our daycare centers, that there we moved from very liberal Office of Economic Opportunity funding to City Department of Daycare, which carried a lot of restrictions with it. And what we've learned is how to fight within that kind of a bureaucracy to maintain the integrity of our program. We've really been able to do that to a great extent with the daycare centers, and it's been there have been a lot of fights and a lot of hassles, but we're fairly happy with what we've been able to achieve. And the thing is that we don't see ourselves surviving forever on foundation money. It just is not going to be there forever, and we have to begin to look in other directions. We also don't want to be just a little oasis for a few kids. We would like to be the spearhead of a movement to get public funds so that a lot of small schools like ours could spring up, and so that schools like ours could be a real alternative to public schools.